what we, to be faithful, you have to have faith in what you are doing. You need to believe in the product, the process, and the proclamation of the work.
Go, but before I leave, go and tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go now for a little while, but goodbye is not the end. Things that I taught you, I conquered death and I hold the keys. Where I go, you will go to someday. There's much to do here before you leave. So go and tell the world about.
Week after Mother's Day, gifts for Mama. Four brothers left home for college, and they became successful doctors, lawyers, and prospered. Some years later, they chatted after having dinner together. They discussed the gifts they were able to give their elderly mother who lived far away in another city. The first said, I had a big house built for Mama. The second said, I had a $100,000 theater installed in the house. The third said, I had my Mercedes dealer deliver an SL600 to her. The fourth said, you know how Mama loved reading the Bible, and you know how she can't read anymore because she can't see very well? I met this preacher who told me about a parrot that can recite the entire Bible. It took 20 preachers 12 years to teach him. I had to pledge to contribute $50,000 a year for 20 years to the church, but it was worth it. Mama just has to name the chapter and the verse, and the parrot will recite it. The other brothers were impressed, and after the holidays, Mom sent out her thank you notes. She wrote, Milton, the house you built is so huge. I live in only one room, but I have to clean the whole house. Thanks anyway. Marvin, I'm too old to travel. I stay home. I have my groceries delivered, so I never use the Mercedes, but I do appreciate the thought. Thanks. Michael, you gave me an expensive theater with Dolby sound, but I've lost my hearing, and I'm nearly blind. I'll never use it, but thank you for the gesture just the same. Dearest Melvin, you were the only son to have the good sense to give a little thought to your gift. The chicken was delicious. So, There you go. So, if you found your place in Hebrews chapter 11, why don't you stand with me, please? Hebrews chapter 11, and we are starting out at verse number 8. Hebrews 11, 8. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whether he went. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore sprang there even of one, in him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is in heavenly. Wherefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, that he had received the promises, offered up his only begotten son. Put in your margin John 3:16 beside that phrase, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the promises of God. We thank you for the being the God that you are, that loves us, that trusts us, that blesses us, and that we in turn can put our faith and trust in you and bless you. Now, Lord, there's no question at times we disappoint you and we are sorry for that, but I pray that it is in our heart's desire this morning to be good stewards of the things that you have blessed us with, that we'd hold nothing back because you have held nothing back. You are the ultimate example, and you have blessed us with tremendous examples of people of faith that have done the same thing. So, Lord, help us this morning to understand the principles that you are teaching us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Question: would God ask you to do anything, ask you to do something for which he would not do himself? Would God ask you to do anything that he would not do himself? I don't know if you've ever thought about leadership qualities or not. My wife and I were out eating out this week, thanks to the generous contribution of someone that had given us a gift card to Texas Roadhouse. A lady waited on us, and we had a conversation, and afterwards, I was reminded of the fact that if there is a dearth in our churches, if there is a dearth in our land, if there is a loss that seems to be becoming a precious commodity, it is the lack of leadership in America, and honestly, primarily in the men, that there are decisions and things that need to be done, and we seem to be raising a generation of lackadaisical, game-playing, couch-sitting. I'm trying to think of the words I'd like to use that are proper from the pulpit to describe the generation that is growing up, that I'd just like to grab them by the scruff of the neck and ask them, where was your father? Because if they're turning out like that, it's not all their fault, although there comes a time when it is their fault, but men need to raise men, and it's hard work for us to do that, and for some reason, guys my age and a little bit younger have shirked their responsibility in training up leaders. Churches are closing in America today for lack of leaders, for lack of pastors that are willing to stand in a pulpit and do the hard work of saying the right thing and doing the right thing and taking a stand for something. Because obviously, if there are people that are willing to take a stand, I believe there are people that will follow. But if there's no one taking a stand, we are as sheep without a shepherd. And that is the problem. And that's why church after church after church after church is closing for lack of leadership. This is not a leadership message. This is a stewardship message. And I want you to know, when you decide to be a steward, when you decide to lead by example, when you decide to put everything that you have on the altar for the Lord and remind yourself that it has always been the Lord's, you are just trusted with it, that you become a leader by being a steward. And I'm hoping I can share that principle this morning. A great leader will have already done in the past, or will be currently doing in the present, what he is asking you to do right now. And of course, we're talking about stewardship. The definition of stewardship is this: a man employed in great families to manage the domestic concerns, superintend the other servants, collect the rents or incomes, and keep the accounts, etc. You and I are under God's employ, if you will, in his great family. He has appointed us as stewards to watch over his resources and the things that he owns. Not us, he owns. And we are to manage those resources. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul is talking about, and he said, we are stewards of the mysteries of God. And obviously in verse 2 it says, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Can we agree that this book to a lost world is a mystery? Okay, they look at that. And can we also agree that sometimes it's a mystery to you and I as we read it? Okay, and so we study it, thankfully, through the Holy Spirit, enlightening God's truth, teaching us God's word. God opens our eyes, but for the spiritually blind that don't know the Lord, this is a great mystery. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, as stewards, you and I are stewards of the mysteries of God. In other words, it's up to you and I, as stewards of truth, of this book, to share those things. I want to say one of the reasons why there is lack of discernment in our churches, and even worse, lack of discernment in the country today, is because they do not know God's word. And somewhere along the line, the stewards, which are you and I, have failed to teach and preach and live God's word. In our Sunday school class this morning, I teach the junior high class, there was a Shunammite woman that was blessed to have a man of God in her presence. And she was going through tremendous difficulty, and she kept wanting to go to the man of God. And over in 2 Kings chapter 4, they call him the man of God, the man of God, the man of God, the man of God, talking about Elisha. And she knew if she could just get to the man of God, then her crisis that she was experiencing could be handled. Now, guys, if you are a man of God, if you are a follower of the Lord, we do not have the miraculous abilities that Elisha had. Wish we did. We don't. But I'll tell you this. We are stewards of God's word. We can share truth. We can pray. We can stand for something. We are stewards of the mysteries of God. The responsibility is on every one of us in this room this morning, if you know Christ as your personal Savior, to be a steward, a teacher, a faithful servant of this book, and live it out so that when people see us, they recognize us as men and women and children of God. And our behavior would show that one way or another. We are stewards, and it's required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Faithful is steady, constant. When I was younger, I learned to fly an airplane. My instructor, whose name was Gary, had this phrase, steady pays the bills. Say that with me. Steady pays the bills. And what will happen, and you will be tempted, oh man, this looks like a get-rich-quick scheme here. If I change my job here, if I leave this and I go to this, I'm going to make so much more money. And then they get to that change and they realize, wow, this isn't what I thought it was going to be. And so then they jump to the next one. And they think, boy, for another dollar an hour more, I could jump over to this one. And so they never stay anywhere. They're always looking for their ship to come in somewhere else. And so my father used to say, a rolling stone gathers no moss. Well, I thought, well, who would want to gather moss? Why do you say that? Well, the principle was, if you stay somewhere and you stay steady at it, you can accumulate something. And moss is accumulated on a stone that stays there. And then it can grow something. Well, if you like moss, wonderful, whatever. I'm thinking, that's just my father. But the older you get, you recognize steady pays the bills. And you can work steady at a $12 an hour job, and it would seem like, boy, if I could get $20 an hour, that would be better. And these are old numbers nowadays. You folks make any, anyway, I don't want to, but those numbers, all of those things, be careful what you're chasing. But if you can just stay steady for the Lord, it's not exciting. At times it's discouraging. I've shared this before, but ministry is the most time-consuming, if you will, lack of result. For instance, and I'm obviously, you wonder, are we making a difference? I was thinking about Garage Talk, and some of you, if you've watched those things, it's a little YouTube thing we do from time to time, and I was thinking about, Emily, of putting on there a message at the end of it. We always run bloopers at the end, and which is fine. But one of these weeks, I want to put a message on there that just says, if these have been an inspiration to you, or if we have made any difference in your life, would you let us know? Because honestly, how do you know if you're making a difference? I grew up in the automotive industry. I switched over to the oil industry. In both of those industries, you work on a car, it comes in broke. If things go well, it drives out repaired. And you can see, and usually we did the fast thing. Brakes, shocks, struts, exhaust, short time, big income items. There are items on your car, front end parts, where the markups were wonderful. The customer might say atrocious, we said wonderful, and we just, obviously, there were things that you could do quickly to make good money, and those guys that wanted to rebuild engines, good for them, but you'd have a car in there for a week, we'd have a car in there for 2 hours, and we could just have a big turnover. My point is, we could see what we were doing, we had a quick turnover, we were getting them in and out, and I could see, that car is fixed, that car is fixed, that car is fixed. We'd install boilers in the oil company, and we could walk into a seller that had an old hunk of junk. We'd take before and after pictures. We'd walk out with an after picture. I could look at the photo. This is what it was. This is what it is. Honestly, that was satisfying. I could see what was happening. Stewardship's not like that. Stewardship is investing in people, doing what God has called you to do, sharing God's word, being stewards of truth, and you share it with your neighbor, and you pray with someone, and you talk to someone, and you invite someone, and you do the whole process that God has called us to do. You share your faith, and you ask, would you like to receive Christ as your Savior? Some people will say yes, and then they trust Christ, and then you watch for results, and you want fruit that remains, and all of those things. And so much of the time, week after week after week after week after week of just staying steady, and you wonder, are we doing anything? You see so little result. Don't look at your Christian service week to week, month to month, even year to year. I'll show you results. It didn't happen overnight. But we started one time in 1994 over there with no running water and all kinds of interesting things going on. And now, you know what? Since 28 years later, we look around. Has God been faithful? Amen? And it just steady. Just stay steady. And other pastors have come and gone in their churches, but we just stay because really nobody else is offering us anything else. So here we are, you know? But do not be discouraged in well-doing, for in due season you will reap if you faint not. And it's so important that you and I be faithful. It is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. To be faithful, you have to have faith in what you are doing. You need to believe in the product, the process, and the proclamation of the work. Don't miss that. If you've ever raised kids, and I've done it a couple of times, we've got a couple of them at home now, just spectacular, brilliant individuals, but I will tell you this, that when you ask them to do something, it's obvious their heart is not in it. Because you either have to threaten them within an inch of their life or something to motivate them to get them to do certain things that just doesn't seem like rocket science. And I know they hate being my kids right now, but that's too bad. Life's not fair, okay? Now, you and I, when we believe in something, we put our energy into it. Isn't that true? When we don't believe in it, we don't really care. Not interested. There's a great teachable moment going on in the world right now. There's a country called Ukraine that has been invaded. There has been a military that's supposedly invading them that's supposed to be superior to any other military out there in that region. But you know what? It's not going well. And that superior military that's supposed to be able to do anything is doing a lousy job at it. Why? Because I don't believe they believe in what they're doing. I think they're on assignment in a place that they don't really want to be. On the other hand, we've got another military that is supposedly not as well funded, does not have the resources, but you know what? They're fighting for their country, their home, their family, their friends, their loved ones. And let me tell you something, they're taking a stand because they believe in what they are doing. Christian, do you believe in what you're doing? Or are you just here because this is what we do? Now, I want you to know there's a huge difference in the faithful that have faith in what they're doing and those that just attend on a regular basis. And only you know whether you truly believe in what you're doing. And as Del Tackett talks about the Truth Project, he asks the question, do we really believe what we say we believe? And that's an excellent question because honestly, Christian, and I'm sorry, I don't want to offend you, but based on our actions and our attendance to the things of the service of God, I'd have to say that we don't believe what we say we believe. I didn't like that. Well, I'm sorry, but I'll tell you what, the things that we believe in ought to affect our behavior, our attendance, our actions, and the things that we do because we are stewards of the mysteries of God. And we are showing that if you don't believe in what you are doing in the service of the King, being Jesus Christ, your effort will show it. Let's take a look at Abraham and Isaac. And we have seen him memorialized in Hebrews chapter 11, but what is being referred to when God asks for his only begotten son is in Genesis chapter 22. If you're using a Pew Bible, that's on page 33 is the passage that we'll be looking at. Genesis chapter 22, the first book in your Bible. Genesis 22, incredible story going on here that God asks for. Stewardship, number one, is a test. Say that with me. Stewardship is a test. And it came to pass, after these things, Genesis 22:1, that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, here am I. And he said, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains that I will tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went into the place which God had told him. And on the third day, don't miss that, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto this young man, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and will come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, my father. And he said, here am I, my son. And he said, behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went on both of them together. And they came to the place which God had told him of, and Abraham built an altar there, and he laid the wood on the altar and bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son, and the angel of the Lord, which would have been a pre-incarnate Jesus Christ, called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham, and he said, here am I. He said, lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him, for now I know that thou fearest God, seeth thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And obviously, that is the sacrifice that is going on, that is taking place. We'll pick it up a little bit later. But number one, stewardship is a test. Take thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest. First time love is mentioned in the Bible is right there, for the love for Abraham and Isaac. One of the tests of the Christian life is priority. Who comes first? In the quietness of your time, when you get home, or maybe in your devotions this week, think about the priorities in your life. Maybe 1 to 5, you'd write down, how is it? What is the priority of my life? Who is number one? Ask yourself that question. Who is number one? Say that with me. Who is number one? Honestly, for times, it was, as a husband, perhaps you'd say, well, my wife is number one. I understand that. Maybe you'd say, my children are number one. I understand that. But if the answer is that you're writing down, if God is not number one, you've got some learning to do. You've got some testing that will take place. You've got some trials that you will go through, because it is imperative as a Christian that God be number one. God said to Abraham, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and offer him as a sacrifice to me. He's asking for the very best that we have. We hold nothing back. Number one, stewardship is a test. We put God first. Matthew chapter 6, you don't have to go to it, but I'll read it to you very quickly. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 19 is a great passage on some of the things that we have. Lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust corrupt and where thieves break through and steal. I'll stop right there. I've had things stolen from me before. Ticks me off. Got home one day and someone had gone in the garage, loaded my toolbox. It was gone. Cowards. They wouldn't do it while I'm there because they'd know I could take them. You know? Thieves don't. They're always looking for the opening where no one's around, where they can get away with it. Drug money, whatever. It's painful to have things stolen. Another thing that's kind of stolen at times is if you have a retirement account. You wonder, I don't even want to go there. Verse 20, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. I want to stop right there and say, Cornerstone Baptist Church, and we don't talk about money a great deal here. We've been criticized lately that we don't talk about some of the projects that we do. I will tell you this. We don't talk about money a lot of times on Sunday morning because we don't want to be that church that says, all you guys talk about is money. We do not talk about money a great deal in this church. You folks are faithful givers, absolutely incredible. If we don't talk about money, that's on me. That's my fault. But you folks for several years have given well over $100,000 a year to missions. You've been a very generous group in your giving and taking care of others. It's incredible all the things that have taken place from a little country church in Exeter, Maine. I hope the Lord is pleased. If he's not, it's because we've not done enough. But I will tell you this, for every dime that you have given for the cause of Christ is well kept. You've never lost one cent. You are getting a tremendous return on your investment, even if for some reason, I can remember a few years ago, now it's been quite a while ago now, we heard of a missionary over in the Philippines that was in danger of losing his real estate and the church that he was trying to build, and he needed a certain amount of money, and we gave very generously for that man to keep his building, only to find out about 2 or 3 months later that that low life was a lousy father and his wife up and left him and he lost his church anyway. And you and I felt led of the Lord to give that bozo a pile of cash. Now, I don't know if that's a spiritual term, bozo or not, but whatever it is. And obviously, humanly speaking, I wasn't happy about that, but I'll tell you this, we didn't give that money to him, we gave it to the Lord. We felt it was the right thing to do. We were encouraged by another pastor, that another church encouraged us to get on board with this because they were doing the same amount. And they asked if we would help, and we felt led to do that, and we did. And I guess it was wrong. And that bothers me. But we didn't do it for that individual. We did it because we thought the Lord was asking, and we did. If you're looking for a perfect track record in your giving, that's not going to happen. You remember, every time you drop a check in the offering at this church, you're not giving it to Stan Griffin. You're not giving it to the leadership of this church. You're giving it to God Almighty. And if we screw up, which by God's grace, our errors have been few because we pray about these things and we ask for God's direction, a lot of times that's just a test to see how things will go. We aren't perfect, but I'll tell you what, we have a heart for the things of the Lord, and we want to honor Him in everything that we do. On that occasion, it's the only occasion I can think of in 28 years. That's not too bad. But I'll tell you this, you've lost nothing when you give to the Lord. I've lost quite a lot in giving to my retirement account. I can't figure out what we're supposed to do, but all of that, whether it's a retirement account or to the church or whatever, every dime I personally handle is not mine. It is the Lord's. And I don't lose sleep over those things because I recognize whether I retire with a certain nest egg or not, which we're supposed to prepare for the future, or whether I lose it all and I retire in poverty, it was always the Lord's anyway. Does that make sense? So that's how you have to look at it. So here we are. Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither rust nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves don't break through and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. We are to put God's first. Stewardship is a test. It's a test. We are told to seek ye first. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. We put God first. We go to church on the first day of the week. We give of the first fruits. Everything about our faith, about the Lord, is first. And it's very important. Number one, stewardship is a test. Number two, what God has given you, you can trust Him with. Do you hear me? What God has given you, you can trust Him with. God gave Abraham a son, Isaac, born of a miracle. He asked for his only begotten son. Isaac was a son of his father's old age. He was 100 years old. Sarah was 90. You don't have kids at those numbers. Not going to happen. I've heard of people getting married at 90. We joke around about whether they're planning on having any kids or not. We know that's humorous because it's impossible. But Genesis 18, 10 through 14 says, and he said, certainly I will return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah, thy wife, shall have a son. And Sarah heard it in the tent door, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age, and it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. In other words, she'd gone through the change. I don't know if some people understand at certain times. Women change. I think women change all the time, but this is a particular thing, okay? Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord also being old? And the Lord said unto Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I surely have a child, which am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? Is anything too hard for the Lord? Say that with me. Is anything too hard for the Lord? What would the answer to that be? No, nothing is. Sarah had a baby at 90. Jesus Christ was born of a virgin. Both equally impossible, but not with the Lord. So we're running out of time. Stewardship is a test. God will try you to find out where your priorities are in everything that you own. He will also ask something of you that you may not be willing to give up. That is also a test. But let me tell you something. If God has given it to you in the first place, He's capable of giving it to you again. Or He knows that He'll take it from you because He figures you're going to not do as well with it as he would if he had it. And so those things are all questions that take place on stewardship. It is extremely important that God's people recognize that God would never ask anything of you that he'd not do himself. And the story of Abraham and Isaac, we'll pick up next week, we'll come back to it, is such a parallel of what God has done with his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. What was the purpose? Jesus died so that you could have your sins forgiven, that you could have hope in heaven. We had a funeral here yesterday, the flowers here from that funeral. Lovely lady, Dolores Bodding, who is now in the presence of the Lord. Her husband, Victor, is with us this morning. Those are tough things, to say goodbye to a loved one. But you know what? She's in the presence of Jesus Christ today. Why? Because she was a good person, because she was lovely, people liked her. No, there's nothing to do with that at all, although those things are very important. She had trusted Jesus Christ as her personal Savior. At some point in her life, she had said, Lord Jesus, come into my heart and forgive my sins. The greatest thing you and I can do as stewards is to give ourselves to God Almighty and ask for Jesus' forgiveness for our sins and come into our heart. And I want you to know, God doesn't want your money. God doesn't want anything you have. This church is not interested in what your income is. The only interest we have is your relationship with Jesus Christ, because you will stand before God someday and give an account for one thing right here. Did you believe or not? You're either a believer or an unbeliever. You are either saved or lost. And I'm telling you this morning, if you have not trusted Christ as your personal Savior, you are lost. You will stand before God as an unbeliever, and you will go into eternity, which means it never ends, forever, away from the presence of God in a place the Bible describes prepared for the devil and his angels. That's not the company that you want to keep. On the other hand, if you're willing to say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart and be my Savior, forgive my sins, then you can become part of the family of God, and God will never ask anything of you that he would not do himself.